Hello and welcome to P Guru's channel. I'm your host Sri Iyer. I'm here today with Sri K N Govindacharya ji. Namaskaram. Welcome to P Guru's channel, sir. It's been my privilege to have known you for a few years now. We have met here and there off and on in different conventions. Sir, for the P Guru's viewers, I would like you to share your from your childhood, how you've been part of RSS. Just walk us down the path of how you grew up. When did you start getting interested in, you know, RSS? And then you've had a very meteoric rise inside. So we would love to hear from you in your own words.
I was born in Tirupati. Father belongs to Tamil Nadu, South Arcot district. In the house we used to speak Tamil. My father shifted to Varanasi in 1945.
I see.
So I, being a child of 2 years age, we all shifted to Varanasi. My education was in Varanasi. When I was in class 9, my Hindi teacher, who was a old communist, but very honest in this life.
I see.
He impressed me because of his approach to concern for downtrodden, fight against exploitation and inequality. That appealed me. And his life resonated with the cause. But as the time went, then I worked for AISF in BSc previous, when I was enrolled for BSc course in Banaras Hindu University in Varanasi. Then came this case of Tibet invasion by China. Then Dalai Lama's exodus from Tibet.
1950s.
So we emotionally were with Dalai Lama and with Tibet in particular. And we found China as we perceived as aggressor. But to that, my communist friends, they had different views.
Yes.
So I got disenchanted. So I was attracted to Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia, George Fernandes, to hear his lectures in Varanasi. We used to walk a distance. Then ultimately, I came into contact in one Sangha Baithak, Professor Sharda Sharan Singh from Metallurgy Department, Banaras Hindu University. He put forth the idea of Sangha in a palatable manner to a student who I was, with a particular background, who had a penchant for reading Blitz every week as regular magazine, and who adored Gandhiji in particular as a great man of Bharat. So, but that meeting, he put the RSS idea in such a fashion that it is the requirement in the post-independence era to inculcate qualities of citizenship in common men.
Yes.
And that is what Sangha imparts those qualities through 1 year, 1 hour shakhas. And to that we all agreed. Then he said that if you are honest enough and morality requires that if you are convinced with that idea, you should be seen in the evening shakha. So that was 16th May. I started going to RSS shakhas. That is 1960. I completed my Sangha training first year, second year, third year consecutively, 62, 63, 64. And by then I was a settled RSS worker in Varanasi, who was looking after all the students' work in Varanasi, as RSS is there. Then I imbibed the idea of coming out as a full-time worker, that is Pracharak. I conveyed this to the officials. So in 65 July, I was asked to be a Pracharak. Then in the beginning for 6 months, I was in Varanasi itself. Then I was sent to Bihar, Bhagalpur University Center. I worked there for 6 months, then I was shifted to Patna, as it is said. That Pracharak is a postcard without address. Whichever address is written on that, he should go. Accordingly, I was shifted to Patna. I worked there. During my work in and around Patna, yes, definitely work progressed. There was a conducive atmosphere also for the growth of RSS during those days, in Bihar in particular.
Right.
And we also had planned that Bihar should rise as a second backup army for the future invasions in the northeast areas by China or all. That spirit we were working. Then I was put in charge of Akhil Bharatiya Vidyarthi Parishad to look after that as a guardian, being a Sangha Pracharak. During that time only, students' agitation erupted, led by an action committee of students, leaders. And in that, my friend Rambahadur Rai also was there in Bihar. Sushil Modi was Union General Secretary. Mm. Lalu Prasad ji was Union President during those days. Mm. So in that agitation, incidentally, accidentally, my name also got involved. And I and Ram Bahadur Rai were being looked by the police for arrest under MISA.
I see.
So I avoided arrest. Ram Bahadur Rai got arrested in March 27th or so. I worked as underground worker. I struck good rapport with Jayaprakash Narayan. So Jayaprakash Narayan ji also accepted, and ultimately he accepted to lead the agitation with two conditions: that partisan attitude should not be there and peaceful methods should be adhered. So to this, nobody had any objection.
Right.
So I was dragged into the Bihar agitation in a way. So from 74 to whole of emergency, 77, I was in Bihar agitation. Ultimately, when emergency was lifted, democratic system restored, Morarji became Prime Minister.
Yeah, but you didn't contest the election?
No, I was underground worker throughout.
I see.
And I was asked to work more in UP and Bihar during elections.
I see.
77. Before that, I was used to work Assam, Bengal, Odisha and Bihar put together. So from 77 to 88, I worked in Vidyarthi Parishad in different capacities, whether it is Central Zone or South Zone or North Zone, keeping my headquarters at Bombay, the headquarters of ABVP. In 88, I was asked by the then Sangha official, Bala Sahib Devras, younger brother, Bhau Rao Devras, that I should work in BJP. To that I told him that a worker successful in one field need not be successful in other fields also.
Right. Not
but about that I cannot be the judge. You people have to rethink about it and then tell me if possible. So after 4 days I was again called that no, we have conferred and you should work for BJP. Then I again asked him a question that what precaution should I take because it's a new field, I don't know. Then he said, do one thing, as you live like a ordinary person, like a Pracharak, continue with that. Your lifestyle should not change. At that moment, I could not understand the importance of this, but as a worker in BJP, I found that yes, this is a crucial, like a Rishi Vakya. So I understood, I went on. It all went on well. I don't have any regrets in that work. But internally, from 1996 onwards, I was not that satisfied for two reasons. One was, we were imminently likely to come into power in 96.
Yes.
And we ultimately came into power for 13 days. Then I thought that after coming into power, what all needs to be done should be chalked out well in advance.
Right.
So some data bank, some policy bank, some biodata bank.
Right, right.
But this idea was not that way relished. By others, when I was isolated in that.
Were you just planning for the
because
organization?
Congress was on the decline.
Yes, yes.
So one force's decline adds to the prospects of the other rival.
Absolutely.
So it is a holistic phenomenon.
Right, right.
So I was thinking that BJP was about to come into power. So we should have adequate preparations. So data bank, biodata bank, and policy banks are needed. So in first 15 days, then in 2 months, then in 6 months, what all should be done? We should be clear about it.
Right.
Incidentally, that was appreciated. Then I thought that all right, at least organization and power structure, there should be some coordination in that. About that, I couldn't succeed. Then I was thinking that yes, some training classes for the workers. Then for running the party, we should not depend on money bags. We should depend on the donations from our own workers and hardcore supporters. That is called Ajivan Sahyog Nidhi. To that, Advaniji had agreed. He was president. Then I was asking one more thing, that for promoting and protecting ideology and idealism, there is a need of scientific style of functioning for a cadre-based, mass-oriented political party like BJP. And that's the core deficiency or the handicap of the political instrument. That's what I was of the opinion. So with that in view, ultimately, with great effort, a conclave could be arranged of the senior leaders, about 40 or so, in Virar, outskirts of Bombay. Meeting was successful. 40 recommendations flowed from that. But it could not be brought into working committee meetings for the 1 year The next 90, up to 98, I was struggling to bring that into National Working Committee for discussion. I didn't succeed. And then Thackerayji became president. We all came into power in 98. I approached Thackerayji once more, but of no avail. So I was losing interest in both the things. In between, on the policy line, indiscriminate influx of FDI was sought.
Yes.
That's my opinion. I may be wrong. Similarly, approach to WTO had different ideas. I was sailing along more with Swadeshi Jagran Manch, I think, policy-wise, approach-wise, emotion-wise. And here the things were different. So at one time, one of my colleagues remarked also, are you working for BJP in Swadeshi Jagran Manch or are you working for Swadeshi Jagran Manch in BJP? There is a dichotomy in this. I said, yes, you are right. I am working as per my ideological moorings, that's what I feel. If there is any difference, let us discuss it. There was no discussion. Then ultimately, one of the senior leaders I had to talk with, traveling from Kanyakumari to Trivandrum, he said that, Govinduji, don't tom-tom much about party with a difference. I said, why? Because BJP can be at best Congress with a saffron tinge. And I said that if that be so, what's the point in sacrificing life selflessly to achieve this little? This little can be achieved by becoming ministers, MLAs, all the swayam sevaks. That will suffice. Said, yes, who asked to? So who asked to work selflessly? That was the question. About that, I did not have any adequate words. I didn't want even to confront. So things went at that. Then I thought that no, challenges are huge. Challenges of transnational companies, multinationals are very heavy. It will take a heavy toll as far as Indian ethos is concerned, culture is concerned, equality, inequality problem is concerned, amelioration of rural poverty is concerned, unemployment is concerned, all this. It is all in conflict with our ethos and our needs, that's what I feel. Then I was working against WTO also. So I thought it that protagonists of globalization, they're also well-studied people. I haven't studied that much. So I had an urge for studies. So then in May 2000, I talked to Thackerayji that I be given study leave for 3 years. To this he said that you can study and work also. I said, no, it's not possible. Serious type studies I want to make. And as being a man of organization, I can't devote time for studies at the cost of meeting people, which I don't. So he said, all right, in a few months I'll be quitting as president. So at that time with the new president we can have this settlement that you go on study leave. And fortunately I got the opportunity. So on September 9, 2000, when Sri Bangaru Lakshmanji was president, I had already talked to him so that no ill will comes into as if I didn't want to cooperate with him. Not that. It's a separate case. I want on my own volition that I want to go for study leave to study the impact of globalization and the counters if needed.
This is 17 years ago.
Yeah, 2000. So 2001 and 2002 I spent for study leave. On the Makara Sankranti of 2003, I met the in charge of BJP from RSS side, he was Madan Das. I met him. We were colleagues in ABVP also for so many years. I told him that my studies have got certain conclusions and that warrant my contribution in a different manner than the political party. I want to get engaged in academic, constructive and educational activities henceforth. With a pro-Bharat and pro-poor approach. So if that I have to do, it will be my venture. And if that be so, first and foremost, my duty is to come to you and tell you that I am no more a Sangha Pracharak. So it's all my venture. I want to do this pursuit. So results also, I'll be responsible for it. So that morally binds me to say to you that I won't need any worker or money from you. Success and failure will be my responsibility entirely. So this he said that it means you won't meet me. No, not that. We'll be friends. Only thing is, till now, right from 5th December 1965, I came out as Pracharak. I was working as postcard without address. Whatever task I had been allotted, I have accomplished to my best of my capacity. About that, yes, some mistakes of decision making might have been there, but not in the intentions. Motive is quite all right. Even today I am that. I am a Swayamsevak. I will continue to be Swayamsevak. So with that, we continue to have dialogue that every 3 months I will meet him, I will brief him. Whatever I also see in and around, I will be communicating to him. That much was the arrangement. So 2003 onwards, I started was actively associating with Center for Policy Studies, Chennai. Then I started one Kautilya Research Institute, headed by a JNU professor. Then on the constructive front, I had visited many places during my study leave. So harnessing all the energies, I started one Bharat Vikas Sangama. It was in November 2004. Then in between there was a crisis, that is Srimati Sonia Gandhi was supposed to become PM. To that, my heart revolted. So I talked to Gurumurthy ji and other my friends also. And together on May 15th, 2004, we floated Rashtriya Swabhimana Andolana. And fortunately, by God's grace, the movement succeeded in a week or so when Sri Manmohan Singh ji was made Prime Minister. And not Sonia Gandhi ji. She herself, on her own volition, proposed the name of Manmohan Singh ji. So that was over. Since then, I have been active on several issues. Now it is 2017.
And now we are back in 2017, and you have recently moved the Supreme Court as an intervener application in the issue of Rohingya Muslims. Sir, P. Gurus has been writing extensively about this resettlement of Rohingya Muslims, especially in the areas of Jammu. There have been Rohingya Muslims in other parts of the country also, but this takes a little bit more of a criticality because the demographics there are subtly changing, and the articles that we were publishing with very, very hard facts that said that given the current demographic shift, that Jammu could also become, you know, a Hindu minority state. And and I think we've had some success in moving the Ministry of Home Affairs to start looking at these things. And but you see, India is such a huge country, it absorbs everybody. And it's very quickly, you know, just because of the short-sightedness of politicians for votes, you know, these people are given citizenship, ration card, all the basic necessities. And suddenly, you know, they are also a voter. And now, in the recent past, like the last few days, there has been another, big surge of Rohingya Muslims trying to move into refugee camps in Bangladesh. Now, how do you see this thing play out? Because this is not the first time India has had this problem. You know, Assam in 1980s, Assam Gona Parishad was started for this something where...
No, West Bengal itself.
Itself is the same problem.
So many districts getting converted to minority dominated.
Correct. Right,
so
right.
Now minority is supposed to be. Now it has been converted to majority.
Majority districts. Right. So how you are usually the thinker's person in the sense you can take the long-term view. Here is what we need to do. So maybe you can walk us through what prompted you to do the IA application in Supreme Court, and how do you foresee this as a more lasting solution? We are going to have these kinds of things in the future also.
As you know, Bharat's partition itself has got the history of the two-nation theory.
Yes.
Based on religions.
Yes.
Religious denominations.
Right.
So demography plays a very important role in deciding the fate and the geography of the nation. One has to underline that, and one has to understand the importance of this aspect, which because of sadguna vikriti, I think, extremism of emphasizing upon the virtues of the virtues, that makes us blind enough not to see the realities. It is right that we have been the most welcoming nations in the world. For others, though our ideology, religion might have been different. So some more than 2000 years ago, since then, Jews have been coming in Bharat.
Right.
And they have been given the religious specialties too.
Mm.
Similarly, Parsis also.
Yes.
Yes, that has been our hoary past, history also.
Yes.
But the challenges then were different.
Right.
And now it is all the difference. We are now in 21st century.
Mm.
In 8th to 10th century, only Parsis were detained in Bharat.
Right.
They were persecuted there. But today, the situation is that everybody is feeling tired of terrorism and they want some solution also.
Right.
The main problem is on the religious domain of the thought process that people do not want to apply or accept the reality that problem is with proselytizing religions. And the whole crusade, whole jihad, which just paupered the whole of Europe and ultimately led to exodus of Europeans into American subcontinent and elsewhere.
Right.
So colonialism was the result of that. But it was basically triggered because of the uncertainty, instability of the whole society, insecurity in the society, economic deprivation and the unstable conditions of those societies. One has to understand that also and give importance to that. That because of proselytizing religions, there is a likelihood of change in demography. And in demography, since numbers count crucially, so the religious denominations, because of their sense of belonging, intense sense of belonging towards one's religious denomination, makes them bind together and get converted into minority vote banks. Now also, if you see interesting, this about Rohingyas themselves. They didn't infiltrate into Mizoram.
Yes.
They didn't infiltrate into Nagaland.
Yes.
But they preferred Bangladesh.
Correct.
And also Bharat.
Yes.
And in Bharat, they can travel so far up to Jammu Kashmir itself.
Yes. Yes.
And wherever, because of A, porous borders.
Right.
B, our simplistic approach to problems of politics resulting into problems of sovereignty of the country itself.
Yes. Yes.
So I was keen to point out, and I was serious to point out this aspect, which I mentioned in my petition also, that we have experienced one partition on the basis of religious denomination.
Yes.
Now also, again, there are many areas which have turned into minority domination.
Yes.
And now also in Pakistan itself, which you see, it is the reverse case.
Right.
In Bangladesh, it is the reverse case.
Mm.
So. And they are being persecuted even Jammu Kashmir some 3 decades back.
Right.
Because of religious denominations only they were persecuted.
Right.
Not that they were Brahmins, but they were Hindus.
Right.
So if you ignore this reality of the situation and just some lofty ideals, lofty wishes, if you, then you end up in utopia.
Right.
And it is vital for the whole society.
Correct.
With this approach, I have approached the Supreme Court for this, that no such facility should be accorded to Rohingyas. And we are not bound by 1951 United States Refugee Convention recommendations. We are not bound by 1967 protocol also. And for humanitarian concerns, there can be hundreds of other ways to cater to the immediate needs. And about that, we should also understand that the problem is a domestic problem as far as Myanmar is concerned.
Yes.
And we always respect that right from 1648 in the whole world, this convention, Westphalia Convention.
Yes, consensus. Yeah.
It says that nobody should interfere into others' domestic affairs.
Right.
So that prohibits us also in that manner. So in this all context, Rohingya problem should be sorted out even for humanitarian considerations. There are United Nations agencies who should take stock of the situation, they should take initiative. And Bharat at best, because of its own all-encompassing nature and liberal views about religious denomination, we may cooperate with the effort. But we should not take the responsibility.
Right.
It is their problem, they will have to solve it.
Sir, thank you very much, sir, for taking valuable time from your schedule. I know a lot of people are waiting to see you, and I would not want to take up any more of your time. I wish you all the best in your endeavors, and I wish you a very long life. You look very healthy and hearty for someone of your age, and I'm hoping that our paths will cross again and we'll meet again. Thank you very much.